Hello, and welcome to the Knitting Type podcast. My name is Sarah, and I am the host of this podcast. And today is Sunday, January 22nd, and I am recording from Fort Collins, Colorado. If this is your first time viewing this channel, this is a knitting podcast. It's a podcast about creativity and the crafty knitting adventures that I get up to on the daily, each and every month, each and every week. So there might be some knitting content, some sewing content, some crocheting, some stitching, some beading. I kind of just do a jack of all trades when it comes to craft work. So this is my podcast channel, and because it's a new year, I'll just kind of reintroduce myself to any new viewers. As I said, my name is Sarah, and I can be found on all forms of social media as The Knitting Type. So on Ravelry, on Blogger, on Gmail, on Instagram, and on Etsy, you can find me as The Knitting Type. And I craft out of my home here in Fort Collins, Colorado, which is northern Colorado, with my two cats and my husband. And I've been crocheting for almost 20 years. Oh God, that makes me so, it doesn't make me so old. It makes me feel so old to be able to say that. And I have been sewing for 14, I've been sewing since like my sophomore year in high school, I think. And I've been knitting for I have been knitting for about 13 or 14 years. I started knitting when I was 24, officially started knitting. And so this episode is going to contain a lot because it has been about a month since I recorded my last podcast, which I just rewatched this morning so that I could remember what I had recorded. And of course, in my last podcast, I said, I'm going to podcast again before the end of the new year. Totally did not do that. Got carried away with the holidays, got carried away with planning for Vogue Knitting Live and attending that and all the fun that that brought. And I just ended up doing nothing in the podcast world except for binge watching a lot of podcasts. So if I remember, I'll recommend some of the podcasts that I binge watched relentlessly over the last month. So this podcast is going to be quite full of content. I'm going to just do a brief review of what I accomplished in 2016. I'm going to talk about my 2017 goals. I'm going to do a book review, a yarn review. I will announce a knit along. I'll announce two giveaways, and then I have hoes, foes, and whips, and then I have knitters in the wild like you've never heard before on this podcast because I went to Vogue Knitting Live and attended a virtual knit night and had an actual knit night. Just all kinds of things. I'm looking at my notes over here, and it's funny because I started these notes a month ago, and so some of them are ancient at this point. So let's go ahead and get started with what I'm drinking. First of all, Christmas, right? Christmas has happened. So this mug was given to me by my mother, which I think is so amazing. And it's full of all of these funny cats and their funny cat facial expressions. And I've already decided which of these cats are my cats at certain times of the day. And it makes me laugh. And you're not going to be able to see this, but the bottom of the mug has a emblem in it, and she bought it from the Feline Rescue Mission or Association, I think. It's the Animal Rescue Site. That's what it is, not feline. The animals, so just animals in general. So I am drinking a pomegranate black tea by Twinings, which is my all-time favorite tea. I say that every time, but I forget that I love it. And then when I was in New York, I found it and I was like, ooh, they have pomegranate black tea. And I got a box. So, okay, Let's get started. What should I start with? Okay, let's do a year in review. So I'm going to refer to my notes a lot because I wrote them over a month ago, so I can't remember what they say. So at the beginning of 2016, and if you've been a longtime viewer of this podcast, thank you. And welcome back. And you have heard this spiel before. And that spiel is that in 2016, I picked a theme word, and that word was yarn. And I decided that in 2016, I wanted to dedicate myself to a year of yarn and everything that entailed. And what it really entailed for me was getting involved in the knit community. So podcasts had started to become really popular and fully saturated in the knitting YouTube world around the end of 2015. And I got into them at the beginning of 2016, planned my word yarn, and decided I want to start a podcast because I want to be part of this community. And I had this goal of creating the theme word yarn as a way of, as like a passport to get into the knitting community and get more involved in the ways of attending events, knitting events, finding knitting friends that were local to me so I could have local knit nights, reaching out to other podcasters and putting myself out there, which is very scary for me. And then just signing up for, you know, festivals or conferences or whatever I could in 2016. So this is a brief summary of what this introvert, who tends to be a little bit shyer in person or just fear of rejection. I don't know that I'm shy. I think I don't come across as shy. It's more of like an internal fear of rejection. So when I meet people, I'm probably overly aggressive or excited. Anyway, so this is what I accomplished in 2016. In January, I attended Knit Knosh and met Becky Kelly of the Knit Actually podcast, and I experienced my very first knitters meetup in Colorado with Becky and my friend Emily Straw of the Knitting Butterflies podcast. It's an audio podcast, and we met at the Loopy Ewe. So those two things happened in January, and that kind of just set everything in motion for me. I hadn't even started my podcast yet. In February, I started my podcast, and I revealed all of the whips that I've had that are, you know, months, days, and years old. And then in March, I went to a book signing for Susan B. Anderson, who I had adored for years and had several of her books. So it was very exciting to get to meet her and have her sign some books. At that same book signing, I also got to meet Hue Loco, Nicole of Hue Loco Yarns. She was there because she also lives in Colorado. I went to another book signing to meet Joanna Johnson, who is the author of a book I will be showing later, as well as several other books like Freddy's Blanket and A Hat for Henry and the Anne of Green Gables inspired knitwear book. So I went to a book signing for her. And then I attended Yarn Fest by Interweave Knits. And I took two sock knitting classes with Kate Atherly. Then in April, I attended the Loopy Ewe's Spring Fling and met and talked to the Yarn Harlot and Franklin Covey. And I met Joan of Lollipop Yarns and ended up hanging out with her and her friend for a majority of the weekend. I think I just kind of latched on to them and they let me. And in May, I went to the Maryland Sheep and Wool Festival. In June, I hosted my very first ever bag swap with Shannon of Soxcetera. And so I made friends with Shannon, which was very exciting because I'd been watching her podcasts and really just find her engaging and intelligent and funny. In July, I attended a Stephen B. event at a local yarn store in Golden, Colorado. In August, I went to one of the stores in the Yarn Along the Rockies, which is a local yarn store yarn crawl for I don't know if it's Northern or Southern Colorado. They have two of them. But anyway, I did. I had had a goal of attending or going to several stores, but I only made it to one. But I made it to one in August. Then in September, I went to the second Knit Knosh with my mom. I won lots of prizes. I feel like something else happened in September and I'm missing it. Also, October is a total blank. I had nothing. In November, I hosted my first ever Cal, which was the Gilmore Girls Knit Along, which was a ton of fun. I also hit 1,000 subs in November, which was very exciting. And I'm extremely grateful to everyone who has chosen to hit the like button on any video and chosen to subscribe and get updates of when I release another video. And I'm going to have a prize for that, so stay tuned. And then I hosted a second bag swap with Shannon of Soxcetera. And then lastly, in December, I got to kind of participate in this thing called Knitting Advent, and where I had an advent calendar and I got something new every day. And so that was kind of fun and exciting for me. And I also participated in the Get Your Yarn Wish Granted, which is a way of interacting again with other knitters on Instagram and swapping goodies. I also went to my first official knit night in December, which was really just Becky and Emily and I getting together and knitting at someone's house, but it happened in the evening, and to me that equaled knit night. I have also attended virtual knit nights in 2016 where someone will host, they'll be the host and they'll, whether through, I think there's some app in Google that lets you do this, but there's also something called Zoom, I think. And so I know Shannon of Soxcetera hosted a couple virtual knit nights, and then Mars of the Hey Brownberry podcast hosted one as well. In November, I did another thing. I met Mars of the Hey Brownberry podcast, I believe, because it was her birthday. And I met someone named Bowen, who is another knitter who lives locally to me. And so I've just met so many people this year, and all because I just set that one word in motion. And I said, yarn. And I did all of these things related to yarn, which ultimately for me were related to knitting and crochet, but they were also related to putting myself out there and making this thing happen. And so I'm really grateful for 2016. It was a rough year outside of knitting, I will say, outside of yarn, but my highlights of 2016, everything fantastic that happened was related to yarn. So that was wonderful. Within that year, the projects that I finished 7 pairs of socks, which I will show my box of socks. I finished 4 shawls, 1 hat. I wrote down 2 coffee accessories. Oh, I think I made little like coffee mug warmer type things. 5 to 6 crocheted hexagons. And I cast on 20 projects, which I am really good in Ravelry at posting my projects. So that's how I was able to recall what I had done in 2016. So as far as my 2016 favorites of what I knit and what yarns I worked with that I really liked, my favorite project was my windswept shawl by Molly Klatt of A Homespun House that I knit out of Anzula yarn in the Nimbus colorway. My favorite yarn was Anzula's Cricut, which is what I knit that out of. It is a cashmere and merino blend. My favorite needles are Chia Goose. I love them. I've actually accumulated quite a lot over the last year. And then my favorite socks, I wrote all of them because I can't wait to wear them and make more. So I guess that kind of feeds into the one Cal that I tried to participate in last year was the Box of Socks Cal hosted by Kristen of the Yarngasm podcast and the Woolen Vine line of yarn. She hosted a Box of Socks knit along for 2016. And I started knitting socks and finishing them, I think, in February or March, and I just had discovered Magic Loop. So I did not get 12 pairs done because I am not that fast, but I will get out my box here and I will show you what I did make. And so this is my beautiful box, which I bought at Joann Fabrics. It's a little bit noisy because I put some of those like smelly sneaker balls in there. They smell like fresh laundry and they look like this. And so they're kind of rolling around inside this box. So these are all the socks that I knit. I knit 7 total in my box of socks. So, whoops. I don't know what that looked like on camera, but when I watch this later, I bet it will be funny. Those were my little shorties that just fell out. So I'm not going to go through and talk about them all because this podcast is going to be long enough as it is. But the patterns I knit, besides plain vanilla socks, were the Hermione's Everyday socks, the Blueberry Waffle socks, the Monkey socks, and then this pattern, which I talk about on my podcast quite a lot, which is by Lydia B, and it's called Susan Ale, if I'm getting that pronunciation correct. And other than that, I knit 3 pairs of vanilla socks. So I knit, those were the 7 socks that I managed to accomplish. I am going to sign up for Kristen's Box of Socks Knit Along for 2017 as well. And I've already started knitting some of those projects. So that kind of gets into my faux hose and whips. And I'm trying to remember because I just watched the Legacy Fibers podcast 2 days ago. And they came up with a new acronym. Whip of the Week is what I think it was called, and so the acronym is WOW. I don't know that I have a Whip of the Week. I don't fully understand how that's a thing. I have Whips of the Week, and sometimes I have a Whip of Weeks that goes on forever. So anyway, you could call them WOWs or you could call them Whips. So let's see, how do I want to get into this? Okay, so we'll do my FOs. I only have 1 FO to show for 2017 so far, and that is because I've given everything away. So one of the FOs that I completed just before Christmas was a sock head hat, and I will try to insert a picture right here of the sock head hat that I knit for my best friend. And she lives in San Diego, so I thought the sock head hat was just this perfect California hang ten, hey dude kind of hat for her to like walk her dog on the beach and look casually awesome. She really liked it, and she's been wearing it ever since. So technically I finished that in 2016, but it is an FO that I haven't gotten to show on the podcast. Then for Christmas, I gave my husband a skein of yarn and I told him he could pick the project. And so he said, I just want the basic hat that you knit for every guy in our family. And so this is a hat by, it's a pattern in a book called, the book is called The Yarn Girl's Guide to Simple Knits. The hat pattern is called Feeling Fuzzy because they knit the hat, I believe, out of some sort of mohair yarn, but it's just a basic stockinette stitch, 4-inch ribbed hat. The yarn is really nice though, and the yarn is wool folk. I don't have the label with me, but it is wool folk in their worsted weight, I believe. You couldn't look on my Ravelry page to see what needles I used and everything. I'm not sure, but it fits him perfectly. One skein of the wool folk yarn was all I needed, and my husband tends to have a very large head. So that I even had some left over, which he was so sweet, and he was like, you should offer that as a giveaway. And I thought, I'm going to save it in case this hat gets a hole in it from just rugged, rough wear. Because I'd want to be able to patch it because it was such a nice skein of yarn and it was a gift and I want to be able to patch it if something were to happen. So thank you, Marie. That's my floating head's name. Her name is Marie, and she is our model. I'm going to put her down. Okay. And then I don't have my other FOs, but I feel the need to tell you what they were because they make me feel productive if I say them. In putting together this podcast for today, I was like, I don't have that many finished objects to show. And then I realized, well, that's because I have knit a lot in the last month, but I've given it all away. So everything was a gift that I knitted. I've just done a ton of gift knitting. And so I knit that hat for my husband. I knit the hat for my best friend. I knit two birds of happiness, which were for a soon-to-be first-time mom who asked that for her baby shower that everyone bring a little bird so they could make a bird mobile for the baby. And so I knit two birds of happiness for that, and I don't have any pictures to reveal, and I didn't take any pictures of them for my Ravelry, but you can Google bird of happiness knitting pattern and you can see what they look like. And then I knit two of the pussy hats for the pussy hat project, for one for my mom and one for my best friend's mom, who I call my other mother, who I've known since I was probably 10. And so they both went to the March for Women's Rights in DC yesterday, and they wore their hats, and it made me feel really great that they asked me to make them for them. So I whipped those up, and that's it. Those are all my FOs. They are all hats and two birds of paradise. So that makes me feel pretty good. That seems like a lot of knitting. That all started January. I probably started my husband's hat right after Christmas. I want to say Christmas night I started knitting his hat for him. So I've gotten a lot done in under a month, but now I'm on the selfish knitting train, and so that's what all of my whips are. So let's see. I'm trying to think in what order I want to do this. I'm going to finish with the Opal Advent Calendar because I have whips in there, but I also want to reveal the rest of the Opal Advent Calendar that I started in my last podcast. So I will show you. This is actually, let's start with this whip. This is my Random Act of Color shawl by Debbie Reese. And I just picked this up last night. I don't think I've knit on it for a couple months now. And this is how big it is so far. So you can see I'm getting into the darkest color section where I will do several repeats in this black colorway. And I am using the suggested Squishy Anzula yarn, which again is cashmere based. And I think when the shawl drapes, it will drape, this way because it's a crescent. I think it's going to take a while. I believe there's over 300 stitches once I finish this dark section. So it's going to be quite thick. I really love it. It's super soft. I can't wait until it's done. My goal had been to get it done in January, but I don't think that's going to happen. So that's fine. Let's see. And then I'm going to have to lean. Actually, those other whips are related to my Vogue Knitting Live. And so if you're new to my podcast, I tend to try to have structure, and then I just end up talking because all of my whips and my hoes and my foes and whatever they are all generally related to stories. So I kind of just tell one big story and then I reveal everything as I'm doing it. So let's just go ahead and wrap up last year by showing you the hose / whips of the Opal Advent Calendar. So this is the Opal Advent Calendar. I revealed days 1 through 11 in my last podcast, which I believe was episode 17. And so what I have done with days 1 through 11 so far, which I think I've just done 1 through 9, is I have knit, I will try to show you, a bunch of these mini socks. So this was day two. And so this is the mini sock that I knit. And I knit it using size 1 Chia Goo 32 or 24 inch magic loop cables or just circular needles. But I think what's interesting to also show is this is how much yarn I have left of the little egg. So I think I'm going to make a bunch of mini hats and mittens and just a variety of each. Like I might have one sock and one hat per set, or I might have one sock and one mitten. So let's see, that was, I should have all the socks just stacked because that would make it easier, because I'm not sure which. Here's one, here's another one. So cute. So yeah, I have a bunch of these. I don't want to show them all because it would just take up too much time on the podcast, so I'll just show a couple. And did I already say this? The mini sock pattern I used is the Legacy Knits mini sock pattern, which you can find on their Ravelry group. I started knitting them using the pattern exactly, and then I decided that I wanted the foot to be a little bit longer, so some of my other socks have just an extra, like, 3 rows. So I'm going to go ahead and scoot my chair back and then reveal the rest of this opal box. And I'll probably have my husband speed up the video so that, it doesn't take up too much time. Okay. So I left off on 11, so I'm going to start with 12. So that's the entire opal box. It was really, really fun to come down every day to my office before I went to work and just see what new colorway I was going to get to knit with. So I think with all of those, I'm going to, like I said, make the socks and the hats and the mittens and then maybe have garland hang up in the background. And then I'll take it like just kind of thinking about stringing it around my office, but then also during the holiday season, maybe putting it on my Christmas tree or something like that. So those are, I have been working on those mini socks since my last episode, whatever date that was. I think it was like the second week in December. And I just started making a bunch of the mini socks. And so those are hose because they're kind of half finished objects in the way that they're part of a bigger project, but it's also a whip because it's a work in progress, and I assume it's going to take me the rest of the year to finish that. And while it was fun, I don't know that I'll get a second opal box because I feel like after the year of knitting all the mini socks, to get another opal box, I don't know that I'd need to. So maybe next year if an advent opportunity opens up in the knitting community, I might participate in that. Okay, and so let's move into, I do have another whip. I have two other whips, well, three other whips, but they're all part of stories. So I'm going to wait to show those until I get to Vogue Knitting Live. So what I would like to do now is actually do the book review that that I had mentioned. So the book I'm going to be reviewing is actually I have the digital version. So I printed the digital version off and yeah. So the book I'm going to be talking about right now is Sherlock Knits by Joanna Johnson. And this is the digital book, which is why it is on this paper and has such big white spaces. But she also offers this book in hard copy in her Etsy store, I believe. It might even be sold on Amazon. And so what I will do is link to her book in my show notes, which will be located in my Ravelry group, The Knitting Type Podcast. So if you are interested in purchasing this book or even just purchasing a pattern from this book, which might be possible via Joanna Johnson on Ravelry, I will link to all of that in my show notes for you. I will also post the information below this YouTube video in the show notes area provided on the YouTube channel, but I'm not quite sure how to do the hyperlinking. So if you want the direct hyperlink, definitely go to Ravelry. So I reached out to Joanna Johnson and asked if I could do a book review for her for several reasons. One, I've met her two times previously, and she is a friend of another knitting friend, but also because her quality of work and her pattern writing is exquisite. And I am a Sherlock Holmes TV show fan, and I just knew that whatever pattern she'd come up with for the Sherlock Knits book were going to be amazing. And so I was right. They are. So a little bit background for me as far as Sherlock Holmes goes. I have not read all of his books. I have watched the entire series on PBS, Masterpiece Theater. It is phenomenal. I will say that it has sparked a fire within me to want to, I listen to a lot of books, so to listen to the audiobooks, which I know my husband has listened to them before, so I believe we have them somewhere in our audio library file in our house. And what Joanna Johnson has done in this book is she has created patterns based off of the book, because I believe how it is that the show has copyright issues. So these are not patterns based off of the show. They are based off of Sherlock Holmes books. The photos are inspired, of course, by the show. And I will say, I don't know who she got to model for the cover of the book, but he kind of is a Benjamin Cumberbatch doppelganger, right? He's just tall and thin, and I think he looks very much like Benjamin Cumberbatch, who I think does a really great job in the TV show of looking like what I would think Sherlock Holmes looks like. So what Joanna has done in this book is very similar to what she did with her Anne of Green Gables book, and that is that because the Sherlock Holmes written books, I believe, are public property, meaning that anyone can access them and kind of copy text from. I hope I'm not getting that wrong, Joanna. I'm sorry if I am. She has been able to sprinkle in some of the quotes and from the various Sherlock Holmes stories. So what you'll see as you flip through this book are quotes or passages, if you will, from certain Sherlock Holmes books, and then patterns that relate to those passages. So one of the gorgeous sweaters that she's created is a sweater for John, and I'm going to flip through and see if I can find a photo that I can show without revealing the pattern. And so this is the sweater for John pattern. And then and it's a gorgeous, it's got a little pocket on the front, so it's one pocket. And she has other gorgeous photos in here that are just very reminiscent of what you would think would be in Sherlock Holmes' home, or in perhaps Mrs. Hudson, his downstairs neighbor or landlord's home, or something any of the characters from Sherlock Holmes might wear. So I'll just kind of show a couple of patterns and then talk about a knit along that I'm going to be hosting. So let's see so this is a tea cozy, if you can see that. That is, I think, super cute, and I would like to make that. I drink a lot of tea. I have a glass pot. I'm not sure. It doesn't really have a spout so much as a lip. But that could work for it. And then Let's see. She's got a pashmina scarf in here. I think based off of something Sherlock Holmes wears, she has a speckled band shawl, which is inspired by the Sherlock Holmes story of the speckled band. And this is what I'm going to be knitting. And these are socks for Mary. And so that's the pattern I'm going to be knitting for the knit along that I'm going to be hosting for this Sherlock Holmes book. So I know that Joanna Johnson is currently hosting a knit along herself, and it is for this pattern called the Scotland Yard Vest. So you can check out Joanna Johnson's Ravelry page, and you will probably see the knit along information there. I'm not participating in that knit along because I don't really have anybody in my life that would wear that vest. My husband's not really a vest person. So anyway, in this book, she has a variety of patterns. She has the vest, she has a sweater, she has a scarf, she has a shawl, she has a pair of socks, she has an iPad or book cover. She has lacy arm bands that go up your arm, and she has the tea cozy, the traditional Sherlock Holmes hat, which I have seen knit up, I believe, Jasmine of the Knit More Girls audio podcast knit this for her son, and so that's the Sherlock Holmes hat, obviously, and so Joanna has included a pattern for that. And I have to say, the digital copy of this book is really phenomenal. I printed it off at work, but the pictures are just gorgeous, and it's just, it's really well done. So anyway, it's called Sherlock Knits, Patterns Inspired by the World's Most Famous Consulting Detective by Joanna Johnson and illustrated by Laurel Johnson. And so again, this is the Sherlock Knits book. Or the digital copy that I have downloaded and printed out. So the book format obviously would be cut smaller. And so I have been talking with Becky Kelly of the audio podcast Knit Actually, and she and I are currently hosting a Sherlock Knits knit along. Now, I was supposed to record this podcast several weeks ago and announced that the knit along started January 15th, which was last Sunday. But because I am at least a week behind in recording this podcast, I'm going to say if you already have a project in the works, then you can enter it into this knit along. And these are my rules. I haven't really discussed with Becky what her rules might be, but if you want to enter the knit along via my podcast, then I will accept WIPs. Patterns from this book that you have already started, and I will accept non-finished items. So you start the project, you know, the project has to be at least 75% done, but maybe you can't get it done by the deadline. And so the deadline was originally supposed to be February 28th, so January 15th through February 28th for this knit along. I'm going to extend my deadline because I am late to the game getting this information out there. So I'm going to say that you have until March 15th to finish or get something 75% complete for the Sherlock Knits knit along. And the reason I say 75% is because I am the worst at participating in knit alongs, and I almost never get anything done, you know, by that time. So, anyway, the total details are, it's called the Sherlock Knits Knit Along, hosted by Becky and myself. Information can be found on my Ravelry page. I have a Sherlock Knits Cal, K-A-L, discussion topic thread already open. It will have all the date information and what can be included. You can start chattering in that thread and sharing projects. And then come March 15th, I will have a finished objects thread open for this knit along for photos to be posted. And then I will pull a winner and the winner will receive a signed copy of this book. So if you find something in this book that you want to knit, you don't necessarily have to purchase the entire book, but because a signed copy, a hard copy of the book will be provided to you. But yeah, so I don't know if that all made sense. I kind of feel like I'm fumbling my words, but I hope it did. I will podcast again before March 15th, and so I will provide more details again. But if none of this made sense and I just totally blew it, please go to my Ravelry page and you will see all the details. With that being said, the Mary's socks that I'm going to be knitting, I'm going to use this yarn. So let's see if I can. So I'm going to be using this beautiful rose color to knit Mary's socks. And this is yarn by O'Loops in their Ascot base. And the color is Pixie Meadow Bright. So that's what I'm intending to knit for the Sherlock Knits knit along. Plop, down on the ground. Okay, so that was our book review. And now I will move on to a yarn review, which also has to do with acquisitions, and a giveaway. So I'm gonna change my notes. Okay. So I basically in December got to attend a virtual, what did I call it? It was a virtual open house, knitting open house. So Jonathan Berner of MJ Yarns hosted a open house for a new yarn line that he was releasing called his Red Label. And with MJ Yarns, he's had a black label in the past line of yarn, and that can be purchased in stores only. So you cannot go online and purchase any MJ Yarns with a black label. But he had an open house, I believe, to release his Red Label, which is a line of yarn that can be purchased online. So he hosted this open house in Lafayette, Colorado. And the day of the open house, we got about a foot of snow in northern Colorado, where I live. And so I woke up that morning and I contacted my friend Becky and I said, I'm not going to be able to make it. Please apologize to Jonathan for me. And if you see anything I'd like, let me know. Well, Becky was so sweet. And she was attending this open house and she had gone to the open house because she's a friend of Jonathan's. So to support him, but also to interview him for her podcast. So Becky has recorded a great podcast with like a 20 to 30 minute interview with Jonathan where he talks about all of his lines of yarn, how he comes up with his colorways, why he started the Red Line product line or yarn line. And you really get a feel for his personality and his creative mojo. So I would highly recommend it. The interview is hosted on Becky's audio podcast called Knit Actually, and it is episode 49. And I believe you can find that podcast on YouTube, or I'm sorry, on iTunes. So what Becky did was while she was there, she and I FaceTimed, and she walked around the venue. And she showed me all of the yarn and anything that I said, ooh, that looks pretty, get closer to that. She would zoom in her iPhone for me, or I think it's an iPhone, her phone for me so that I could see what the colorway was. And I would say, ooh, get that one for me, get that one for me. So basically she was my yarn mule and she purchased all of this yarn for me. And then of course I paid her back instantly. But because I was supposed to attend the event and because I host a podcast, Jonathan very generously offered me a skein of his yarn to give away on this podcast. And he's also offered this podcast a discount code, which is good through February 15th. So you have about 3 to 4 weeks to use this coupon code at mjyarns.com where you can purchase some of his Red Label yarn. And that coupon code is in all capital letters, podcast. So that coupon code will get you 15% off until February 15th. Now that I've said that, let me show you the yarn that I got. It's going to be a little bit noisy. I have it in a paper bag with his sticker on it. So that's Jonathan's sticker. And here is the yarn that I got. Okay, so I got this beautiful Red Label yarn on his Tough Ram Heavy Fingering Base. That's 80% superwash merino, 20% nylon. And it says, it looks like these sheep were raised and milled in the U.S. of A. And this is 360 yards. And the colorway is called World. Like to swirl, world. Not like the planet that we live on. Isn't that beautiful? I just loved the blues and this pop of orange I thought was really pretty. And then to go with that, I got another, what's this Tough Ram? Yeah, another Tough Ram Heavy Fingering, so all the same properties in the aquamarine colorway. So this is the aquamarine, and I thought that these two would go really nicely together, obviously, in some sort of shawl or something. Whoop, dropped my show notes. Okay, and then I got this peachy purple color. And what I also kind of like about Jonathan's skeins of yarn is that he very loosely wraps them up. So, you know, that just means that the fibers don't get a lot of stretching in his skeining process. So this is on his Black Label, which can only be purchased at a store. But he had a bunch of them on discount. So when Becky went by those skeins of yarn and they were something like $10.50 or $13.50 for a skein of yarn, I was like, get me that one. So if you have a chance to see his yarns in store, this one is on the Simple Sock Fingering Weight Base, 75% superwash, cordale, 25% nylon, and it's 380 yards. And this colorway is called Madonna. I don't know why, but you'd have to listen to Becky's interview with Jonathan to hear how he comes up with his names. But this one, I believe I'm reading that correctly. This is the back of the label. So it looks to me like it says Madonna. And this is the front of his labels. And I also kind of think, actually, that it could go well with this because of these pops of coral in the skein. And then I believe I got another one, but it's upstairs. And it kind of has roses and corals and purples in it. But again, I left it upstairs. So I got two red labels and maybe three black labels because the price was out of control. And then I believe Jonathan was also offering us like a 5 or 10% discount that day for his open house. So this is again on his Black Label in the Simple Sock Fingering Weight. I did re-skein this so it's a little bit tighter. But this colorway, the reason I got it is because it kind of reminded me of Dirty on Purpose, and it kind of by Yarngasm, Volin Vine Yarns, and it was just very manly. And I thought, I don't have a lot of manly colors, and Jonathan does have a lot of manly colors, and I thought I could make something for one of my brothers or my husband or a male friend in this because it's just very, I don't know, I would say masculine, but earthy looking. The colorway is called Mice and Men. And actually, there's a pattern that I will show in a little bit that I think this yarn would be really great for. It just has some beautiful rusts and grays, and you can see this kind of yellowish, tarnished bronze colorway that I think is really pretty. So those are the yarns that I got from Jonathan that I purchased. And then this is the one that he provided as a giveaway for this podcast. It's gorgeous. It is a single ply superwash merino, 380 yards. It is on his 1U fingering, and the colorway is Trillion. And it's just, it's really pretty. It looks on the camera like there's some blues that are showing up, but there are no blues. So, let me see. Or maybe there is. Is that? Oh, yeah, I guess over here there is some blue. I was just looking at the wrong side of the skein. So, it's just these beautiful, like, amethyst purples and blacks and apparently this splash of blue. And it's really, really pretty. So if you would like to be entered to win this skein of yarn, I will ask that you head over to the Ravelry group, the Knitting Type podcast, and leave a comment under the show notes answering the question, what would you like to make with this yarn, knowing that it is fingering weight, 380 yards, and a single ply. So what pattern would you use for this yarn? If you'll just leave a comment on the show notes, I will pick a winner under my next podcast. Or on my next podcast, not under. Okay, show notes. Okay, moving right along. We have the cowl. We have our reviews and recommendations. And now I'm going to talk about knitters in the wild and the holidays. So for the holidays, I got a lot of lovely presents, and I just kind of wanted to take a minute and show some of the ones that I got that were on my knitting wish list. So the first one that I will show you is up on this little shelf next to my desk that was not on any type of wish list, but that my husband so thoughtfully put in my Christmas stocking, and that is this ball jar lid. So he gave me four lids like this. They have this little hole, which I believe is probably intended for a straw so that you could drink a beverage out of a ball jar, which I know is really trendy. But I saw these and I immediately thought I could thread yarn through that and create a little yarn jar, essentially, for my minis, because I have all these minis laying around or in bags or in vases or however I'm trying to store them. But how great would this be? So I put a couple of minis from my Harry Potter minis club that wasn't a Ziploc bag, and I stacked them kind of like a, oh no, I'm not gonna be able to think of what that word is when you've got like a dessert and it's got all those layers. Anyway, kind of like a little dessert jar full of minis. And what I will do is I'll remove the first mini, I'll ball it up, I'll stick it back in the jar, and I'll pull the thread out through the top, and then that way the mini ball won't roll away, and it's not going to be mixed up with a bunch of other yarns in a mini bag, and I can just kind of keep them very tight and organized. So I have four of these. I'm not going to show you all of them because you get the idea. So that was a present I got that was really thoughtful, and then I got this from my mom. And it is made by Chia Gu. Let's see if you can see that written on the front. And this holds a cake of yarn that you want to, instead of pull the yarn from the center, you want to pull the yarn from the outside. And so this spins. And so you can pull the yarn. I was trying to see if I have one. Let's see. Oh, I just dropped so many things. Whoops. So you would kind of take this and shove it right over the top like that. And then you would be able to pull from the outside and the yarn wouldn't go away anywhere. So I got that from my mom. I did also receive some 9-inch circs in Chia Gu. So I'm very excited to try those for Christmas, or for Christmas, for sock knitting. And just two other things. My sister-in-law got me these beautiful handmade buttons. They're ceramic buttons by One of a Kind button company. So she got me this beautiful green sheep and this beautiful, I think they kind of look like snowflakes or jacks. Like if you ever played jacks as a kid. I have another little lamb. I have a big lamb. Woo. And then this is just a beautiful swirl design, but I think it's so pretty. And then, so this is the business card. It's Candace Wilson, clay artist, I'm not sure where she's based out of. Does it say on there? Oregon. She's based out of Oregon. So this is her business card. And she makes beautiful ceramic buttons. I haven't actually done a lot with buttons. Like, I haven't attached them to shawls, and I haven't made any sweaters lately. So that's going to be a goal for 2017, is to make more sweaters, but also use buttons, because I have them and I don't want them to go to waste. And then the last thing I'm going to show you, I got several books. They were all on my wish list. They were all books I wanted, so it was very nice to receive them. But one book that I got that was not on my wish list, that I did not know existed, and that I love, because I love when people buy me things off my Amazon wish list or something. I always love the generosity of anyone that wants to give you a gift. But when someone sees something that they don't know you would like, because you haven't said, but they have a feeling, and or they know you so well that they see it and they say, this just screams you, that they buy it for you, or they're so aware of your interest. I think that's just really heartwarming. And so my mom, who is not a knitter, found this book and got it for me. And I think it's just beautiful. It's called People Knitting, A Century of Photographs. And the back says, Hollywood starlets between takes, London cabbies and Shetland Island fishery workers on break, World War II nurses producing socks for the war effort, high school boys and Victorian dowagers, even the abolitionist Sojourner Truth, all found relaxation in this quintessentially compelling craft. The colorful amphora and delightful vintage photography of people knitting showcase a century of people who were mad about knitting, a charming tribute to knitters everywhere. And it really is. It's full of just these beautiful photos that someone collected over time. And I don't have the rights to show any of the photos on the inside of the book, so I'm not going to, but I can tell you that every page has at least one, if not two, photos and or graphics of people knitting, and there's very little verbiage. So it's mostly a coffee table book that you just flip through. And I believe that because these photos were found or sent to the person who put the book together, you just don't know the stories behind the photos necessarily. So it's mostly just a photo book, but it is beautiful. And the binding, I don't know if you can see here, it's bound in this yellow tape that has knit stitches on it. And People Knitting is the title. So I'd recommend this book to anybody that loves knitting as much as I do. You don't even need the pattern. Just looking at other people knitting through the centuries and the history of it and the heritage of it is a beautiful thing. So those were my knitting acquisitions for Christmas. And so now I will get into Vogue Knitting Live. I have to take a sip of tea. It's too much to talk about. I don't even know how long I've been talking because I can't see it on the camera. So I hope it's recording, because I don't think I'll be able to do this again. So Vogue Knitting Live was amazing. I was there Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. I mostly attended the event on Friday because I was taking a class and attending a lecture and then attending the marketplace. And the reason I could not really get back to Vogue Knitting Live for very long periods of time on Saturday and Sunday was because my mother had taken a bus up from Maryland, and my little brother lives in New York and Brooklyn. And so I kind of used this trip as a way to see my family, who I had not gotten to see for the holiday season, while I was in New York. So I had one full day that was just for me going to Vogue Knitting Live, and then the rest of the time I sprinkled in, you know, visits to the marketplace while I had some time in between, or while my family was patient enough to let me wander back inside to buy one more skein of yarn. So I will put in a series of photos at the end of this video so that you can kind of see what my experience was while I was in New York as a whole, not just at Vogue Knitting Live. But Vogue Knitting Live is amazing, and it's, I think, really affordable, other than you have to get to New York City and then maybe find a place to stay. So I didn't, the Vogue Knitting Live was hosted at the Marriott Marquis, which is in Times Square, off of 45th and 44th Street, I believe. And the Marriott Marquis is kind of like a convention center and a hotel. So they were offering a discount on hotel rooms, but they were expensive. They were around $230 a night. And I'm lucky enough to work for a hotel company, so I get discounts on rooms, but I can't get discounts on something like a convention center or when there's a big event in town. If there's an event and the hotel is sold out, my discount doesn't apply. But what I was able to do was find a hotel a couple blocks away, about five blocks, and get a room at the rate of $80 a night, which is unheard of in New York City. So my mom and I shared the room, and I arrived by airplane on Thursday, and she arrived by bus, and my little brother met us, and we all went out to dinner on Thursday night, and it was wonderful. And if you've never been to New York, it's just, being near Times Square, there is a plethora of restaurants and amazing food to choose from. And having your own tour guide, somebody that lives there that can recommend places or say, let's go over here for the best pizza, or I've had some really great wine over here, is extremely helpful. So my little brother helped my mom and I navigate kind of where we wanted to go and eat. And I had a couple things on my bucket list that I was like, I'm in New York, so here are the things I want. I want a really good glass of wine. I want a really great pizza, New York style pizza, and I want a bagel with cream cheese. And I can say to you, a bagel with cream cheese, and you might think, well, can't you get that at your grocery store? You cannot get a New York City style bagel at your grocery store. If you ever go to New York and you are not lactose intolerant or gluten free, have yourself a bagel with cream cheese from a highly recommended bakery or bagel shop, because they are phenomenal and they are best. They are the best that I've ever had. So I managed to check all those things off my bucket list. So anyway, on Thursday night, my brother and my mom went with me to registration at the Marriott, and I picked up my Vogue Knitting Live booklet, which, you know, told you kind of where your classes were and what the schedule was for the day. It also has a ton of advertising, of course. So this was like Friday's schedule of classes, because you didn't know via their website where your class was going to be hosted. So it was really important to go to registration, I thought, the day before and get the book and kind of plan out where I was going to be first thing in the morning. So I went and did that. I'm kind of looking to see if there's any good advertising in here to show you. And then I took a bunch of silly pictures. So it's just like advertising, like a magazine. I took a bunch of silly pictures of myself with all the posters and stuff set up. And then also in this booklet, which is of course helpful, are maps of the convention center so you can see where you're going. So that of course is necessary because the convention center is very big and Vogue Knitting Live is such a big event that it takes up multiple floors in this convention center. So if you've ever been to a convention center before in various cities, some of them can be quite wide and expansive, because maybe it's in Las Vegas and Las Vegas is one big sprawling desert, and so the buildings tend to be low and wide. Well, in New York, New York is an island and it's very tiny, so they build everything up. So the Marriott Marquis is more of a tall building instead of a wide expansive building. So the Vogue Knitting Live event was on several different floors. We had registration on this floor, and you had the marketplace on two different floors. And then I think there were displays and exhibits on other floors and things happening. So you kind of just went on the escalator a lot, or the elevators. So that was Thursday. And then Friday I got to go and take a lecture with Amy Herzog on proper fitting for sweaters, and that was really great. And I have two of Amy's books on proper knitwear fits So it was really great to see her in person. And she kind of, her lecture was very similar to the content that's in her books. It was just an hour long, but it was kind of nice to have the opportunity to ask Amy any questions that I wanted to, which I did, because she was talking about necklines and what neckline looks best for your figure. And she'd said, you know, if you're larger chested or low chested, then you want to wear patterns that bring your chest up. And then she said something about if you have, you know, broad shoulders, then you want to wear sleeves and necklines that do this. And my question to her was, what if you're large chested and narrow shouldered, which is what I happen to be. And she had this great suggestion. And she said, sweaters with really big cowls in the front, because you're going to get the texture that brings the chest up, but you're going to have something that also broadens the shoulders. And she knew it right off the top of her head as soon as I asked. And I was like, that's why you write the books, because you know the things and you know them quickly. And so I cannot wait to make a sweater with a very large cowl collar and hopefully have it custom fit for my body according to her books. So after that, I had like 10 minutes to run down to the local Starbucks and grab something to eat and get to my next class, which was Fair Isle Knitting with Susan B. Anderson, which was so exciting. And I walked in and I put my stuff down, and Susan and I made eye contact, and she's like, I remember you, Denver, right? And I said, yeah, my name's Sarah. And she said, yeah, you're the Knitting Type. And I was like internally freaking out and going, oh my God, Susan B. Anderson knows who I am. But what I said, trying to be cool, was, well, that's nice. I feel like I came off like a smug a-hole. Pardon my language, but I was like, that didn't sound right, and I don't think I made the right facial expression when I said it, and now I sound cocky, and like, because inside I'm freaking out, and all I want to do is hug her and be her best friend. So I might have scared her a little, or you know, just made a bad impression. I don't know. She was still very nice to me, but I tried to kind of back off and not be too needy. She had a classroom full of people that she needed to talk to. So she had all of this beautiful Fair Isle knitwear laid out, and I was going up and taking pictures of everything when someone tapped me on the shoulder, and I turned around, and she said, are you Sarah from The Knitting Type? And I said, yes. And she said, hi, I'm one of your subscribers. My name is Barbara. And I was so excited that someone who watches my podcast was not only at Vogue Knitting Live, but in a class with me, and that I could talk to her. And I had been sitting at one table, but after about half an hour, I packed up all my stuff and I moved over to Barbara's table, and we sat next to each other and chatted the whole time. And she was so funny. And she has a podcast called Flame and Fiber Podcast on YouTube. And I can't wait to watch it, because just talking to Barbara, she was really funny and had a lot of personality. And she also gifted to me some blown glass bead stitch markers. So these are the stitch markers, and she makes these, and they're gorgeous, I think. Now, I asked her, and she said she doesn't sell them, but if you like them, I'm sure you could private message her and see if she has any. Apparently, she just does it for fun as a hobby, and they have this nice little metal stamping plate at the bottom. And they just seem really well made with flex wire. So Flame and Fiber Podcast is her podcast, and she was a delightful classmate to be around. So the pattern that we were making in class was a Fair Isle hat, and it's called the Double Braid Sampler Hat by Susan B. Anderson. And this is it. And she had said, you know, you probably want to cast on the young adult or child size to be able to get it done in class, but it's a 3-hour class, so you're probably not going to get a whole hat done unless you are Susan B. Anderson, and then maybe you can make it happen. This is how much, and of course I've dropped some stitches. Ooh. This is how much I was able to get done, and I can tell you right now, I have not picked it up since, of the hat pattern. So I got one, I think it's called the Lactavian braid. So this is the braid on the hat. I got this much done in class. I probably could have gotten more done if I had thoroughly listened to her instructions and done all this ribbing before class. So that's the outside. This is the inside where Susan really, you know, focused on, I think these are called your drags, when you drag the yarn in between the stitches that the yarn is needed for. So she talked about keeping a loose tension. Of course, this braid is a very unique technique. So she focused on teaching everybody that and really taking her time and coming around and making sure everyone was getting the general idea. And so I made the kind of like older child's size. So I'm thinking this might fit my niece next year for Christmas. I feel like she kind of has a big head, but it might be her hair that looks big. I don't know. I'll see if it fits her, and if she wants it, she can have it. So that was the pattern I worked on in class, and I sat around a table with a lovely bunch of other knitters, and we laughed and we had a great time, and it was a wonderful class. But I cannot lie to you, my fingers started itching as soon as there was only half an hour left in class, and Susan started talking about making a pom for the top of the hat, and in my head, I was going, yeah, I get it, I gotta go, I wanna get into the marketplace, I wanna see what's there. Because if you took a class on Friday, you got early access entry to the marketplace. And if you signed up for a class, it automatically came with a 3-day marketplace pass. But I can tell you that I went to the marketplace on Saturday and Sunday, and it was so crowded because that's when the public, the people not taking the classes or not teaching the classes, have access. So Friday was really the best day to go to the marketplace, but you could only go if you had taken a class or were teaching a class. At least that was my understanding. Other people might have gotten in. I don't know how they did it. I didn't. I had to take a class. Anyway, I digress. Here are some funny things that happened at Vogue Knitting Live, and then I will show you my acquisitions. I saw my first YouTube knitting podcast celebrity in my mind, and I freaked out and had a terribly dorky moment. I would not blame this person if they never talked to me again. I'm walking down the first aisle of the marketplace, of which there were four aisles, I believe, four or five. And I hear this voice. And it is such a distinct voice in a sea of female voices that my ears pricked up and I go, that's Eric from Sticks Plus Twine. He's here. And my sonar, or whatever it's called, my ear, was like, oh my God, there he is. And I see him, and he's talking to somebody, and he is talking to a vendor. And so, you know, I kind of do this thing where I'm like, I walk by, like, I see him, but I don't want to look uncool, and I don't want to interrupt him. So I was like, I'll just go to this booth over here and then I'll go talk to him. And so I'm over at a booth and I'm looking at yarn and I'm like, da, da, da. Meanwhile, not really paying attention to the yarn, but more or less kind of eavesdropping without really hearing anything that they're saying to see if their conversation has finished so I can go over and introduce myself. And I linger for 5 minutes and I think this must look so awkward. I'm just going to go down this aisle, and if I see him again, I see him again and I'll introduce myself then. And then I have another line of dialogue in my head where I go, no, Sarah, this is why you set your intention for the year of yarn. And if you don't make an effort to go over there and meet him, the opportunity might never present itself again, and you will have let it slip through your fingers. And so you need to go over there and say hello. So then I turn back around and I go back to the same booth I'd been lingering at. And somebody comes up and asks me if I'm liking what I'm touching. And I'm like, yeah, shh, shh. And then I decide I'm waiting too long and I'm going to go interrupt his conversation because that's the rudest thing to do. So I go over there and I say, I'm sorry, I don't mean to interrupt, but I do mean to interrupt because that's exactly what I'm doing. So I don't know why people say that. And the vendor goes, oh yeah, no, sorry, we were just wrapping up. And Eric's like, oh yeah, it was really nice talking to you, to the vendor. And then the vendor looks at me and she goes, is there something that I can help you with? Thinking that I'd come up to talk to the vendor. And I said, oh no, I actually wanted to meet him. And then everybody laughs and it's so funny. And then I get to talk to Eric, and he is delightful, and he takes his time and talks to me. And It doesn't appear that he really knows who I am, which is totally fine. But, you know, I was like, hi, I'm Sarah. I host a podcast called The Knitting Type, and I watch your podcast, and I was watching your Vlogmas, and I'm so excited you're here. I didn't realize you were going to be here. And so we kind of talked about what classes we were taking and stuff, and then I feel like the conversation got to that awkward point where we had nothing to say to each other anymore, and I still wasn't leaving. So he eventually said, well, I'm actually going to go, I'm meeting some friends here, so I'm going to go look for them. And I was like, oh yeah, okay, can I get a photo? And he was very nice and said yes. And so we posed for the photo. You'll see that at the end. And it was just really nice and generous of him to give me so much time. And I appreciated it, but I felt like a total tool bag. And then we go our separate ways. And so then I'm walking down the second aisle and I see him again. And I had put my hand in my pocket and I was like, shoot, I have business cards. I brought knitting type business cards to hand out to people. Oh, shoot. And I don't know why I did this, Sarah, but I interrupted him a second time. And I literally walked up to him and I was like, sorry, I just want to give you my business card. Sorry to interrupt. No big deal. Anyway, sorry. Okay, bye. And I walked away. And I was like, okay, well, good. That's done. I'm never going to do that again. And I will never talk to him ever again if I see him in public, because apparently I don't know how to conduct myself properly in a knitting forum. So, yeah, that happened. And that was the most embarrassing. And then I was going through some other booths, and I was in the booth for the Neighborhood Fiber Company. And I might have been on the second floor at that point. I might have worked my way up. And someone tapped me on the shoulder. Oh, shoot. Okay, someone tapped me on the shoulder, and I turned around, and it was this beautiful woman and her mom, and she said, hi, I'm Cafe Verona. I told you on your Ravelry group I was going to be here, and I was going to say hi to you if I saw you. And I felt terrible because I didn't remember, because I didn't read her the second message she'd left or something. But again, it was just so lovely to be recognized and for someone to come up and say hello to me. And she was lovely, and her mom, and we chatted for a bit. And then I was telling her how I'd made a fool of myself in front of Eric. And then I was like, actually, he's right down this aisle. I just saw him a third time awkwardly. He's going to think I'm stalking him. And we laughed. Ho ho, how funny. And then she was like, really? He's here? Where? And we both peek our head out of the booth, and I was like, he's right there. And there's Mina. And I lost it again because I don't know how to behave in public. And I was like, shh, get back in the booth. Get back in the booth. Look casual. And thankfully, Mina started walking down and came into the booth, and we introduced ourselves, and she was lovely, and she recognized me, which was really nice. Or she seemed to, anyway. If Mina didn't recognize me, totally understandable. But the way in which she said, hello, made me feel like she did. So even if she was faking it, she does a really good job. And we all posed for photos together, and you'll see that too. And Mina's delightful and just one of the most beautiful pregnant women I've ever seen. And it was such a pleasure to meet her. And then I ran into Hohi Locatelli and Vera Valimaki as well. Also made a total fool of myself. And so that's just me making a fool. And I asked them for a photo, and I was like, I'm going to knit your project, and I've already knitted one of your projects. Can we take a photo? Okay, great. Smile. Yay. Pretend like we know each other. And they did, and it was lovely, and then they went on their way. And so that was my main meeting people. I didn't really meet anybody else. I've seen everybody else's photos. I know that everybody else. Oh, no, I did. I totally did, but that's on Saturday. I totally met two other people that are kind of significant. Anyway, I didn't meet anybody else on Friday night. I did buy a lot of stuff. I'm going to show you all my acquisitions after my stories. So on Saturday, I went back to the marketplace just for 2 to 3 hours. My mom was with me. I bought her a marketplace pass so she could come in and shop with me, and we were going to spend the day together. But I didn't want to have her spend all of her day with me because she wanted to go to the Strand bookstore, and my mom is a writer and an author, and a poet, and so going to the bookstore was going to be a really big deal for her. So I think I spent about 2 hours there and bought more stuff, and she, in her very sweet mommy way, was like, let me buy that for you, sweetie. No, let me, I want to treat you. Let me buy that. So, but we get there, and the first place we go is to the Do You Knit booth, which Do You Knit is a yarn store in New Jersey, and she sells a lot of hedgehog fiber, and she and Stephen B. often share a booth together. And so I wanted to go back to that booth. I'd seen some yarn. I was interested in possibly getting, I hadn't purchased it on Friday, and so I was interested in potentially getting it on Saturday. And so my mom and I are turning this corner to go to the booth, and I see Sue and Chelsea from Legacy Knits and Legacy Fiber Arts Yarn Company. And I got so excited, and I was like, Mom, it's Sue and Chelsea. You don't know who that is. It's fine. I know who they are. And so I was like, I brought presents for them because they provided yarn for me for my Gilmore Girls knit along. So I want to go and give them their yarn. And Mom goes, okay, sweetie, do you want me to go with you? And I said, no. And she was clearly hurt. And I was like, I'm sorry. I just don't want to be embarrassed. I feel like I'll embarrass myself. So no, you just stay here. It's fine. And I denied my mother the right to come over with me and meet other podcasters, which is awful. So I go over, and they saw me and they recognized me, and we hugged, and we totally clogged up a table where there was yarn for sale. So we stepped off to the side and we chatted for a bit, and I gave them their presents, which were two Gilmore Girls project bags and some yarn from a local dyer here in Colorado and some buttons and badges and stuff. So I was really glad that I saw them because I had brought this stuff in my carry-on luggage, which meant I got to offload it, which meant I got to buy more yarn to carry home. But also, just to meet Sue and Chelsea was a total delight. They are just as charming in person and personable and kind as they appear on their podcast. And we all took photos together. And the funny thing there is we asked someone, I think a stranger, to take the photo. And so the three of us are like, smiling and posing, and then this woman, I see her in the corner of my eye, is like over here taking a photo, and as we're smiling looking at this one camera, I go, that's my mom over there. So my mom had snuck up, just like a mother does, always watching their children, and watched the whole interaction and decided she was going to be part of it anyway, and introduced herself to Sue and Chelsea. And she was like, I'm the mother. And so we had this whole, I'm the daughter, I'm the mother interaction. And I don't know why I told my mom she couldn't come. Everything was fine. I get nervous. So that was really, really fantastic. And then Mom and I just shopped and had a wonderful time, and I came back on Sunday and I did another little hour of shopping, and then I boarded a taxi and I got to the airport and I left, and that was my Vogue Knitting Live experience. So I will show you some of my acquisitions that I also totally dropped on the floor, so I'm going to go pick those up. Excuse me as I walk away. I have so many acquisitions. Because you only attend Vogue Knitting Live once, maybe more if you can convince your significant other or family that it's worth the cost to fly out there. So let's see. I'm going to show you first some cute things. There were all kinds of vendors and booths. I apologize. I'm going to be leaning a lot. So I went to the booth for Knitty, I think it's called Knitty City. Yeah, Knitty City. And when you purchase something from them, you got this bag. And so, yeah, a shopping bag. Oh, I got recognized there too. The woman who was selling everything, I didn't get her name, but she asked if I was the Knitting Type. She goes, I recognize you. I know you. You have a podcast. Are you the Knitting Type? And so that was really exciting. And I told her, because I bought this at the Knitty City booth, they had this at checkout, and I was like, oh, Eric's here. Eric Lutz of Rib Magazine is here. And she was so excited. And she's like, oh, I hope I get to meet him. So I picked this up because I hadn't had an opportunity anywhere locally to get it yet. And so I thought, what better place and what better timing than on the weekend when I made a fool of myself in front of him than to buy his magazine. So, or it's a magazine. It feels like a book, but it's a magazine. So if you're not aware of Rib Magazine, it is a knitwear magazine full of men's knitwear. But really, I mean, I would wear this sweater, right? Because it looks super comfy. And so most of his patterns, I feel, are unisex. But that's just, you know, often because there's that idea that women can wear men's clothing and still look cute and cool. And it's not always the opposite, but I don't know. Who knows? So I had held up this skein of yarn before and said, I think I have a project I know I want to use for it. And so the project I'm thinking of, excuse me, my nose is so itchy. I have to go to town. Okay. So this is the project that I'm thinking about making. And I don't think that you can see any of the pattern really there. It's a cowl. And I feel like it's knit in almost the same exact yarn. It's a cowl called the Metropolitan Cowl. Oh, and it's by Mina Phillip. How funny, because I met her too. So, yeah, and it's, let's see, I didn't see what kind of yarn you need. Hopefully, oh, it's DK, and that's a fingering. I can just make it bigger, you know, just keep making it bigger. We'll see. So that was a pattern that I found in here right away that I thought, well, maybe I'll just make that, right? Okay, so I bought that, and at the Nitty City booth, they had these really cute socks, and my mom was like, I'll buy those for you, sweetie, because I thought they were adorable, and they're by Living Royal, which I believe is a UK-based company. This doesn't say. But hello, they're socks and they're yarn and they're cats and they have glitter on them. I don't know if you can see the glitter. So they were super cute and mom bought me those at the Nitty City booth. And I believe I did not buy any yarn there. The very first yarn that I purchased was from the Lux Adorna booth. It was the first booth I saw as soon as I walked in, and I got their fun size bundle. And this is 100% cashmere yarn, 360 yards. And clearly this is 8 little skeins of yarn all bundled up together. And it comes with this little ring to hold everything on. And it even came with a pattern on the back of the label. Called the Lila Cowl, which I believe I saw displayed next to this yarn, and it's like a chevron based cowl that you would use this with. So oh, it's so soft. So I saw this on display for $40, and then I went and went to check out and they couldn't find the pricing, and I was like, oh well, I think it's $40. I think my camera's slipping. So anyway, I saw this yarn, the price tag said $40, and then I go up to checkout and they were like, oh really, it should be $55. And I was like, well, the sign said $40. So we go over to the sign or where I picked this up, and sure enough, it said $40. And he said, I'll give it to you for $40 because you just saved us from other people finding that. So I got it for $40. It's supposed to be $55, just FYI. Okay, and then I also bought, which just fell on the floor, this wash and stain bar soap, which is for their cashmere yarn. So it smells delightful. And it's by, that had hair on it, The Laundress, biodegradable, non-toxic vegetable soap, borax, and essential oils. Okay, then I told you I went to the fiber company and I bought this neighborhood fiber company. I bought this skein of yarn in their 1600 Penn Avenue, which is a colorway dyed and inspired by Michelle Obama. And they were going to discontinue this colorway because the Obamas were leaving the White House. And so I wanted to get my hands on it. I got it in the studio sock, which is 100% superwash merino, 400 yards. So I got that. And then I got to go to the Narwhal Needleworks booth and I got 2 skeins of their yarn. Aren't these just gorgeous? Definitely gonna be a shawl. Obviously, this is meant to complement this. So Let's see. This purple one is called Pharaoh. It is on the Rogue base, which is fingering weight, 75% superwash merino, 25% nylon, 462 yards. And then this, this colorway is the Farmer's Daughter. I am such a mess. So Pharaoh and the Farmer's Daughter together in one. They were really lovely. I didn't get to talk to them too much. I did give them my business card because by the time I saw them, I realized I need to give people my business card. So I did that. And then the last day that I went back, I stopped at this yarn booth mostly because I'd spent all my yarn budget, but they were like discounting their yarn on Sunday. So that is the good thing for going on Sunday. Is that sometimes the vendors will discount yarns. So I got this, which is called Shirsty Cat Designs by Kelly Straub. And her website is shirstycat.com. And this is on her Just Sock base, 462 yards, 75% superwash merino, 25% nylon. And the color is Garden of Good and Evil. Ooh. So pretty. Okay. I have some other things to show and other things to reveal, but I'm going to stop this podcast now because I've just realized that my camera is doing this and it's slowly starting to angle down, and I don't know why, but I feel like I've blathered on long enough. I have some other things to show, but I'm going to do that on my next podcast, and I'm going to reveal 1,000 sub podcast giveaway. So if you are watching this and you're not a subscriber, but you want to be entered into the subscriber giveaway on the next podcast, go ahead and subscribe. And yeah, if you liked this video, I apologize for the chaotic nature of it. If you liked this video, please hit like. If you would like to subscribe and be updated on when I'm going to have other videos posted to YouTube, then go ahead and hit the subscribe button. If you want to be entered into the yarn giveaway for the MJ Yarns giveaway, go ahead and check out my Ravelry podcast group called The Knitting Type Podcast. Leave a comment under the show notes for this episode answering the question what you would make with that yarn. And if you want to join us for that Sherlock Knits knit along, please check out the knit along information thread on my Ravelry group under the topic thread Sherlock Knits Cal. Thank you so much for joining me. Thank you for sticking with me if you've held it out this long, and I will see you next time. Bye. I don't even know where the stopper is. This is such a hot mess. Found it. Okay, bye.